Hello, everybody. This is Green Room on Air, and my name is Ray Renati, and I am the host of this podcast. We talk to famous people, not so famous people, and all kinds of people in the world of entertainment. And today is no exception. Today we are speaking with Toasters and Moose. Friends of mine, actually, Toasters and Moose. And if you don't know who Toasters and Moose are, get out from under that rock in which you are living and get out in the world, because Toasters and Moose is a viral sensation on the TikTok and the YouTube and the Instagram. Their real names are Estelle Piper and Tom Shaw. Now, one day, about 6 months ago, I was scrolling through my Instagram and I saw the incredible hit cult song, Taste the Biscuit, sung by Toasters and Moose in the mockumentary, Chickens in the Shadows. If you don't know what I'm talking about, you're going to have to watch this interview because it's a little confusing, but it's also very entertaining and a lot of fun, because once you hear the song, Taste the Biscuit, you will not be able to get it out of your head. It is the proverbial earworm. Today, my guests are Toasters and Moose. And as I said, their names are Estelle Piper and Tom Shaw, and I've known them for years, and I am so happy to have them on the show. And first, we're going to have a little clip of Taste the Biscuit, and then we're going to go right into that interview with Toasters and Moose. So you better not go away. All right. Toasters and Moose.
Taste the biscuit. Taste the goodness of the biscuit. Taste the honey sauce. Taste the goodness of the biscuit with the honey sauce. Don't get that honey sauce on me. I don't like the way it tastes with my chicken wings. Taste the biscuit. Taste the goodness of the biscuit. Taste the butter spread. Taste the goodness of the biscuit with the butter spread. To get your butter spread all on me. I don't like the way it makes.
All right, we have Toasters and Moose on today, otherwise known as Estelle Piper and Tom Shaw. Yeah. Piano Man. Hello. Thanks for coming on.
Yeah. And
I was so amazed when I was scrolling through my Instagram and I saw the Biscuit song. And I was like, wait, I know these people.
Yeah.
I'm like, what the hell is this? And here you are. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
So
This is
what's the name of the movie that we have Toasters and Moose as the stars, is called Chicken in the Shadows. Is that right? Chickens in the Shadows. Yes. Oh, yes.
Yeah. So we shot that in a week, going all over Northern.
No way.
Way. That's how organized that Virgo guy is.
Wow. He is super talented.
Yeah. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
How did this all come about? Did he have like auditions, or did you know him?
Yeah. Well, in fact, Tom and I, we didn't know him. Tom and I have slightly separate, well, very separate stories. I was on a casting website and I was looking to do more camera work. And I saw this and I went, oh, okay. It's going to be kind of a commitment, blah, blah, blah. So it was a long character description. She's pretty complex. She's not the nicest gal. And
no.
At the very end, it says, at the very end, it says, actually, her voice isn't that bad. And I went, I think I can pull that off. And then I get cast and I said, oh, who's playing Moose? And he said, oh, this guy from San Francisco, Tom Shaw. So, you know, the internet was not quite in 2009 what it is today, but I Googled him. And he's got a website and he's a jazz musician. He's got his own jazz trio. He's a pianist and singer. And I'm like going, I can't sing in front of a guy like that. I can act in front of a guy like that, but I can't sing. Meanwhile,
I was on Craigslist and I was looking under this category, like gigs or something. I don't know. Occasionally I'd find audition. I hadn't done a lot of act. I've done some acting and really no film acting. And I'd always wanted to be in the movies. And so there was this category. I don't even know if Craigslist is still around, but it was like gigs. And so, yeah, Vincent had posted like a casting notice and he was looking for a dude who was in his mid-50s, which I was, kind of overweight, and playing a character who's a singer-pianist, who's mildly depressed, kind of quiet. I mean, it was kind of, a lot of that was me, or the me I used to be many, many years ago. So I'm like, oh my God, I'm perfect. And he even said, singing and playing piano not required. So I thought, well, I can do that. So who knows what'll happen. So I went and auditioned and got the part. And then I did the same thing. I asked him who's playing Toasters. Her name's Estelle Piper. I'd never heard of her. Our paths had never crossed. So I Googled Estelle and found out she's a playwright, a director, Shakespearean actress. I'm like, oh, shit. What have I gotten myself into?
Yeah.
So
but you did it.
But yeah, we sort of, what is it you say, Estelle? Like,
oh, yeah. So we were both terrified, but we confessed to each other. And it was like, girl, I got your back. You're doing great. I'm there for you.
We compliment each other.
It totally worked because, I mean, it reminded me of the old films where you had like the Estelle kind of, your character Toasters, who's kind of, you know, like out there. Aggressive in a way.
Oh yeah, just,
and then you're this Tom. You're like the perfect straight man. I mean,
the fall guy.
Yeah, the fall guy, and like even in the songs, like when she's singing, and then all of a sudden you come in with a kind of sharp you. I'm like, it's just like so.
Sorry about the eardrums.
No, but it was so perfect. It's like it's almost in tune.
Right.
Which is what makes the movie great. It's everything's almost in tune.
Well, and he writes these catchy songs. And I think he did a great job of kind of, and I don't think he meant to lampoon them. I think he was kind of going, I mean, I love 70s music, but he makes them just catchy enough that you can't get them out of your ear, but they're just a little off.
Yes. So,
and I think that he subconsciously did correctly because you understand why these guys had one hit and one album and that was it.
Yeah,
I was gonna say Vincent writes the songs to sound kind of out of tune.
He likes
and really like stuff. Interesting and weird in a good way, chord changes and stuff.
Yes,
predictable.
Yeah.
No, very not. Like the one where you're around and around and around. That's actually my favorite one.
Is it?
The stealing that I sing in the BART station, you know, that is pretty jazzy and there's a lot of changes in it. And I turned to somebody I was with at the time and I was like, oh my God. And he said, Estelle, these are not easy songs to sing.
No.
Like, and he was like, no. And I was like, oh, okay.
No, they're so not. And
if I blow it, I'll just toaster it, right?
So when there were other people around, were those actual extras, or did you just do it and then see how those people reacted?
Yeah.
How did that?
He would often just take us into a situation and set it up beforehand, usually.
Yeah.
That we were coming, and you know, it'd be filmed. But it would often be, you know, like in the thrift shop, they just let us come in. And those were employees and customers, except for the guy with the banner, who was our manager, obviously.
Yeah.
But then other times we just open mic nights. So when we went to Britannia Arms and that guy Hunchback played.
Yeah.
So he was cast, you know.
Okay.
And
so that was really funny.
Oh, yeah. But like in the BART station, people just walked up and we just rolled with it, you know.
Yep.
So in the thrift store when you're singing the Taste the Biscuit song, those people were actual customers and employees and stuff.
Yep,
absolutely.
Because at first they're like looking around like, "What the hell is this?" And then by the end of the song, they're like dancing. And then the camera angles were so good. Like even the one in the BART station, I remember he saw it happening. There was like an old homeless woman walking up the stairs.
Yeah.
And as you're singing, like there she is. And it just added so much to the shot. It was genius. Like this, like who is this guy?
Yeah,
and then you played it so straight.
Yes.
And that's what made it so funny.
Yes.
Oh, and that's why so many people, when the song went viral last year, were like, oh, who are these guys? When are you going on tour? And, you know, like they think we're
a
couple.
Have a website?
Yeah, they always think you're a couple, right?
They believe that we're a real singing duo and
we're married.
But yeah, we pulled it off and made people believe it was a real thing.
My wife and kids are going crazy because I, like, sometimes during almost every day I walk around, it gets in my head and I can't stop singing "Taste the Biscuit, Taste the," they can't stand it anymore.
Well, there are people who go, "This thing has been in my head for 2 weeks or 3 days." And we're like, 13 years.
So I also watched the reunion movie, which was also
the video
hilarious.
At the mobile home park.
Yes,
that's from 2019.
Oh my god,
that was great!
Yeah,
oh my gosh.
Oh yeah, 30 Dirty Celebrities and the Underside of Fame.
Yeah, and the guy with the sandwiches, just these little things.
He's in the new movie too.
Oh, he is.
The gal who plays the manager, she was actually an actress friend of mine who just, you know, stands there. She's
in the new movie.
No, that was in the reunion one.
Oh, okay. In the reunion. Oh, yeah. She's the one just standing there. Oh, okay.
And
yes.
And then
then
there's a guy, there's two guys on a couch that kind of go.
Yes. Yes.
And they were, one guy was a crew person. The other guy was a friend of hers. And then the other people who walked through it, you know, we're just people that came through the clubhouse, and Vincent would go, "When you walk by the door, would you go like this?"
What was I going to ask? Oh, how did you come up with the character names? How did he, like, what does Toasters signify? I have an idea.
I don't, you know.
Maybe you know more than we do.
We ask him this stuff, and he goes, "Fuck, I don't remember."
Oh, that's great.
But I think he just wanted something absurd to kind of go with the absurdity of the movie, you know.
And the title doesn't really mean anything either, I guess.
Chickens kind of chickens in the shadows. They do.
I guess so, yeah.
Well, there's no, as far as I can go. Yeah, there's
but
no
you're not chicken.
Title,
I mean, you're... What's that?
Well, I was just saying there's no mention of the title in the movie.
No. Neither are your real names ever used. You're only referred to as Moose and Toaster.
That's not true, actually.
Yeah, actually.
Oh, real? Oh.
Yeah.
When are they?
The end, actually, in the song, the one song he gets to sing by himself, "You Shit on the Ground" or whatever it's called.
I say, "Miss Marcy Brenham, you're such an elitist bitch."
That's you?
Okay. Yeah. And then I call you by your real name during our phone conversation, right?
Oh, you do?
Yep.
Yeah, but that's...
Oh, I didn't notice.
It's Mark, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, I didn't notice
that. Mark and Marcy.
Oh, my God. No wonder they changed their names.
I mean, but there's so many funny things, like the girl, the young girl, I think she says one line, right? And she says, "I hate that," or...
"I hate them."
I hate them. I was waiting for her to talk. It's like,
okay. I know. And when we drop her off, and Don Allen gives her a $20 bill, so we'll be back tonight.
Yeah. And that's a boring place that a teenager or an adolescent would never want to be. Like,
oh, yeah.
And then we never see her again in the movie, which is...
Yeah, right.
Right? Or she spend our tips on a damn bear, so, or a mask or whatever.
Yeah, your tips. Your tips. I'm like, I was like, yeah, you got tips. the guy who plays your manager.
Yeah.
So in the first scene when I see him, or the second scene, I guess, I'm like, no way, come on, this is ridiculous. And then he kept up that personality the whole movie.
Oh yeah.
And it's like, oh my God, I actually know this guy. You know, versus, you know, I mean, I've known a few people, you know,
yeah,
a
he
few
was people very like good. This. Like, he was very good.
Yeah, I mean, he just, he keeps up the over-the-top kind of goofy.
He was like to completely... me, he was like if Robert Preston had a cousin.
Yeah. Yeah.
And
was, like, yeah, sorry. Hopelessly enthusiastic about everything. Like, it will never get down on until you leave.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We'll go to that laundromat cafe.
So, they really had a place like that, I guess.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, the Brainwash Cafe.
Yeah. Yeah.
In San Francisco. That was a very popular spot.
I remember that.
For years.
In fact, yeah. Most of the locations are no longer there. Malibu Grand Prix, the Brainwash Cafe, Epi's Cafe, Panama Red, a little club that we sing Rock Your Body Home in. I can't remember.
The thrift store in Los Banos.
Yeah. Long gone. Yeah.
But we're still
Britannia here. Arms is still there, right?
I think so.
Maybe. They may have moved. Maybe that chain is still, you know, around.
Yeah.
Oh, what's the other place? Louis? Was that in Sacramento where we did the Chopin scene?
Oh, that one. Yeah, I don't know. I wasn't there for that one.
The Chopin cover band. That
oh, my
great.
God. I love that guy who played the leader of that band.
Yeah.
Yeah, he was playing like air guitar the whole time.
Connor.
Not Chopin. Not bloody. We play Chopin.
I loved it when they were arguing over Mozart and Chopin.
Barry, who played... Barry, who played piano flawlessly in that scene, is also in this new Vincent Gargiulo film.
Oh, good.
Small part.
Yeah. Yeah. And actually, the gal who played Jan in the reunion one that you were talking about, Ray, she's in this new movie, too. It's The Dark Crusader, but it's Vincent's Dark Crusader.
Is it the new one that's on that's like a half hour long about Des Moines, Iowa?
No.
It's one that's not.
He's still shooting this new one.
Oh, yeah. Oh, okay.
And I think it's going to be closer to an hour. But if you've looked on his page, it's one it's called Duluth is Horrible, and it's a black and white.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's a really wonderful mood piece.
Well, I saw it was in color. Duluth is.
No. Oh, I think you're right. I think it's the trailer that's in black and white. Maybe.
Yeah. Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. I started watching it, but I had to stop because I'm going to finish. It's only like a half hour or something.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And like you had, Estelle, you had some of the most hilarious lines. Like one of them that stood out to me that was just so bizarre and funny and sick was like, I think you said like Hitler was an artist or something like that. And just the way you said it, I mean, you were so straight about it.
I
like,
had to fucking sell that line. I mean, I grew up with the producers, the soundtrack to the film, the producers, where he goes, you know, Kenneth Mars goes, Hitler was an artist. He painted an apartment, two coats, one afternoon. And I'm like, okay, I really have to sell this shit.
But you didn't, like, you didn't. You just said it so, like so ephemerally, like it was such a like it was like this incredible deep thought that you had, you know, without a lot of you didn't.
I don't know what the hell else to do because it was. How can you get away with saying something like that these days?
I know.
Right?
It was so out of the blue too.
Yeah.
A WTF moment.
A what?
WTF moment.
Yeah. Yeah. We had quite a few of those. It was like.
Yeah.
And
yeah, I mean,
make remarks about how cruel I am to the kid. Get that creepy kid out of here!
Oh my God! Like,
yeah,
at the Malibu Grand Prix.
Oh yeah, yeah. Whoa, and then when we're sitting outside after Britannia Arms, and I go, she's just a little, I don't know, a little some derogatory term that gets in the way.
Yes, totally. And then when you met the swingers at Malibu Grand Prix.
Well, actually, that was at Britannia Arms afterwards, and they wanted us to come to the hot tub.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And then Moose forgot his swimming didn't have his swimming suit.
Oh, I didn't bring my swim trunks.
Right.
And then they like said how they liked it. And all of a sudden, the camera cuts and like You can sort of see you guys running away, but mostly it's just you're not there anymore.
Yeah, well, I get this look like you are kidding me. And then I sort of drink up and get out, and then Moose kind of evaporates away.
So how come Toasters is kind of nasty?
Yeah, she's not the nicest. I figured it was someone in his past, and then, you know, I was maybe helping him exercise that. I don't know. But yeah, she's not the greatest, and she does get humbled, you know, when she leaves and, you know, on that train ride and realizes her dreams are like.
Yeah.
And she has to call Moose and say, look, I was a bitch.
Yes.
I'm not over being a bitch, but I'm trying, and I miss you, and I miss playing with you.
Yeah, that was cool. I liked that scene. It was very redeeming scene for you. It made me realize that I think Toasters, from what it looked like to me, is she just was very ambivalent about doing this tour in the first place. And
well,
she realized
it was
going to
be
pretty,
a whole other thing.
Yeah, and as soon as, like, from day one, when you had to go into the thrift store and sing, that was it for you. Yeah. It's like, okay, this is a nightmare, which I think just put you in a permanent bad mood.
Yeah, that's what my character was not a happy camper either, but he was just pretty quiet about it until he got the song to sing on the street corner all by himself.
Yeah. And then you play with that other band. And I think when Marcy calls Mark, you know, later on, you know, she realizes she has, you know, she hasn't been that cooperative. She has stepped on toes. She has hurt people. And she's not like totally redeemed or anything like that, but it's a big realization for someone like her. And I think Mark Moose is better about his boundaries because he doesn't really give a lot. You know, she really has to kind of talk him in.
Yeah, yeah. I really like how you did that scene, Moose. Yeah, I mean,
the song?
The song was great.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, but the phone call, how you handled.
Yeah, the phone call. Yeah, like you didn't easily do what she was trying to get you to do.
You
were really good. That was good.
Well, thank you.
Really good. Yeah. Yeah, it kept the tension, and you could see where the difference in your personalities. And
yeah.
Yeah, that was a great scene at the end there. I mean, it kind of brought it all back together and made both of you, you could understand both people. It's just a great movie. God,
you know, originally Vincent was going to
film.
Vincent was going to end.
It is a cult film. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Well, I was going to say originally Vincent was going to end after the Chopin scene with the drummer going.
Oh.
He was going to end.
He didn't.
And he decided to, you know, kind of finish the story.
Oh, I'm glad he did.
Yeah.
So are we.
It wouldn't have been the same movie.
He has all these things running through it. One of the things you probably notice is that there's definitely an underpants theme.
Yes. Yes. Like you had the he sent in the America's Got Talent video with the underpants song. Yeah. And then there's the underpants reference.
In the acting class.
Yes. Where you teach them how to act the scene, and they were much better than you. I have to tell you, Toasters, I'm sorry.
And she believes she's so much better than them. And then when she's packing to get the hell out of the tour, there's underpants all over the motel room that she has to pack.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
Toasters and I, Estelle and I, go on TikTok live now almost every week because we're, you know.
There's fans.
Yeah, we have a lot of fans. So we go, and the song I'm Not, or Where's My Underpants is a request we get almost every week.
Yeah, it's pretty popular.
People love that song.
I'm Not Homeless, which was actually written after the movie. Some people,
of course, Taste the Biscuit.
Yeah, yeah. But, you know, sometimes people go, can you do Steely? Can you do Spooky Tune?
There you go.
Yeah.
I mean, your biscuit is the entree, your biscuit song.
Yeah.
And then the rest is like dessert.
I guess, yeah. Sometimes it is like the appetizer, and then we move on to. Sometimes they have other song requests because we want to do other things too.
Well, and we did a 4-song holiday album, Christmas album last last December. Yeah. So we have a Christmas song called Christmas Biscuits. Yeah. Have you heard that one, Ray?
I haven't, but I'll go find it. It's on YouTube. And are your song, is there like a soundtrack on Spotify or anything like that?
It's on Bandcamp.
Oh, Bandcamp. Okay. I saw that on Bandcamp. I haven't had a chance to listen yet, but
I don't know if it's, I know some of the music is on Spotify and iTunes.
All the streaming services, I guess. Yeah.
But whether the soundtrack, I think, for sure should be on Bandcamp and then beyond.
Yeah, it is on Bandcamp. I saw it yesterday. And there's all kinds of remixes.
Oh, my God.
Oh, amazing.
Everywhere.
We should send you some of those because, I mean, some of them are from, you know, like hip hop artists, which actually kind of goes back to our roots in 2010 and 11 when it went kind of viral then. And George Lopez featured on his show
with Billy Ray Cyrus.
Yeah, some of his guests would sing it. And then we had all these hip hop kids making on YouTube back in 2010 their little versions of it, and kids from the Midwest, and then Fish fans. I mean, what kind of demographic is that? It was wild.
I didn't hear about it back then. It seems like it's bigger now. It seems like surge is bigger, right?
Yeah, but it kind of does.
Yeah. Like, so this is not something. This is not a flash in the pan thing. So this is. This is continuing and growing and becoming, it has its own life.
I mean, it's called.
So one person will post Taste the Biscuit on their Instagram and get a million views just from like one person.
You mean like from a celebrity or just?
Not even a celebrity, that's just somebody who has a lot of followers. Yeah. I mean, maybe they are a celebrity and I don't know it, but.
Yeah. But that was another thing too. I mean, people like Snoop Dogg and Pee Wee Herman and all these other
Westlove, they all posted it last year.
Yeah, and there's still people posting it. And then these studios, there's this one called Company Dumps, and then one of the guys in that is King Killer Studios, and they did it like a disco version with like wild lights, and then they did a grunge version, and then they did kind of a funk hip hop version
with Biggie.
And they used AI to get Notorious Big to rap to it. It's wild. We should send it to you because we're just like going, I heard that. Oh, shit. That's
going to hit the
clubs. That's going to hit the clubs.
Notorious Big. Okay.
Yeah.
Yes. I want to hear that for sure.
And then there's other ones too. You know, there's all these things that, you know, sometimes it's fans or, you know, just other musicians and stuff. There's one that's kind of, there's a couple that are kind of fun where, so they can duet it in TikTok. So
yeah,
and add their screen to your screen next to it or whatever. So there end up being three really good musicians that are like playing drums, playing bass, playing guitar. And then Tom, I saw that one. I think you tagged me on it. Somebody else playing like a guitar today. Yeah. But it was more country, you know, like.
Yeah. Wow. On TikTok, it started out with. And, you know, a lot of people do this on TikTok with different videos, but they took the original Taste the Biscuit video and then some guy duetted it and added a guitar track. And then somebody else added a bass track and then the drummer. So it gets layered and it becomes like this incredible.
Yeah. This great jazzy piece. And you're like, whoa, nice.
Oh, yeah.
Well, when I played the Billy Ray Cyrus singing that the first little part there, my wife goes, whoa, he sounds good.
Yeah, he's got that lounge thing down, right?
Totally.
Taste the biscuit.
There's also a death metal version, which I personally love on YouTube. Death metal. Taste the Biscuit death metal.
Oh, yeah, wow. And there's stuff that's kind of Caribbean. And there's a guy from, a guy or gal, I'm not sure, from Africa, who does this. I can't even mimic it, but it's totally great. It's got a great groove to it.
People sing it in different languages.
Oh, yeah. There was one with back when they were doing the vacation lady, the Chrome lady.
Yeah.
Are you familiar with
TikTok?
That?
No.
Okay.
No,
so for a while, it was called the vacation walk, and it's this
filter.
Yeah. And your face is put on top this Chrome female body wearing a short off the shoulder purple dress on the beach. And somebody started doing Taste the Biscuit with that. And it just went on and on and on and on. But there's one, there's a kid from Wales wearing that because it became a Halloween costume. and he's singing it in Wales, in Welsh, you know. And I saw one in Irish Gaelic too. And they're like,
incredible.
Oh, they translated it?
Yeah. I mean, they're singing it in their language.
Oh, neat.
And I would love to get more of that and go, taste the biscuit, bringing people together globally.
Yeah.
What the hell?
There's so many versions. And to this day, people are still just now hearing the song for the first time. And they have no idea, like, who did it originally.
Yeah, so we're constantly explaining ourselves. Yeah, like,
I'll see some, like, funny, like, TikTok thing where somebody is lip-syncing to our song, and they think, oh, this is a new song.
Yeah, yeah. I think it was a couple, 3 months ago, Far Out, which is a British magazine, featured us and, you know, the song and everything. And it was a whole new pile of people from those islands going, what?
You know? Like, what's this? What's this song?
What the bloody hell is this? You know,
maybe you can end up on like the Tonight Show or something.
Well, we're on Access Daily with Mario Lopez, who goes, now, are you guys a couple? And I had to be a smart ass and go, a couple of what? But but yeah, Rolling Stone interviews right away and all these other.
Oh, you got an interview on Rolling Stone?
Oh, yeah.
Right away.
Great,
that was last year.
Oh.
Great Rolling Stone article.
Yeah.
Oh, I have to find that.
Check it out.
Okay.
Yeah, it was pretty succinct. It was good.
Yeah, and it talks all about the Chrome Lady thing.
That too.
So have you made millions of dollars on this yet? I'm kidding.
Internet fame does not pay the rent. No,
we have made a little bit.
Yeah.
Cameo requests, you know, for greetings and stuff on the Cameo.
Oh, that must be fun.
It is fun. It actually made, you know, I'm going to come circle back around to this, why we keep doing it, at least personally.
Yeah.
But also our merchandise is, maybe because it's the holidays, our merchandise is taking off a little.
Oh, so, I bet,
you know, it's
yeah.
a little pocket change, which is
great. Yeah, yeah.
Buys, you know, groceries or gas. But really, if you knew how many, and when I say kids, I mean from 20 to 50, maybe, how many kids have written in and said, I have been depressed for so long, and your song was the first thing that made me smile or laugh in whatever time period. 2 months,
well,
2 years.
I had the same experience. I mean, not necessarily like terribly depressed, but it's just like there's something about.
I know.
Especially Taste the Biscuit. I mean, I don't know what it is, but it just makes you smile. I mean, it's so wacky.
It is.
It's, I don't know, playful. It's wacky. It's weird. It's catchy.
Well, it's playful, and it does have, you know, a potential double entendre and all that.
Right. At first, kids, it seems like that.
Yeah. Yeah. Kids love it.
Well, at first, it's like the double entendre thing going, and then that kind of disappears, and then it's just about not screwing up my Kentucky Fried Chicken. You know, it's like
there was a girl on TikTok who did this lovely kind of revelation of hers, and she said, you know, life is like the biscuit. You do want to taste the honey sauce. You do want to, you know, the butter spread and this is that. And she goes, but if you don't want it on your chicken wings, you set your boundary. I mean, it was a whole thing. And I was going, oh my God.
It was really deep. I loved it.
I mean, it was very heartfelt. And
I bet.
And to make people happy. I mean, even on our live shows, people go, this is the bright spot of my week. And you're like, wow.
Yeah.
That's amazing. So when is your live show? It's on TikTok?
Yeah.
Is that right? When is it again?
Well, we have been doing Fridays, but right now we're not using the studio. So I'm getting over to Tom in San Francisco when I can. And then we kind of go from there. Sometimes we just, like yesterday.
Last couple of weeks, it's just been spontaneous. We got together to do
videos.
It's like, oh, let's go live. So
yeah.
So people have to have their like notifications on or whatever.
Yeah. Yeah. Although we still end up getting a fair chunk of people, which surprised
me. Oh, yeah. We had 950 viewers yesterday or the other day.
Yeah.
Wow.
So if I know ahead of time, and we might not know till 2 days ahead of time and go, okay, you know, it's confirmed.
Yeah.
Then usually one of the other of us may do a quick, you know, video on TikTok and throw it on the rest of the media just to say, hey, it'll be Tuesday at noon.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So in the film, was it all scripted or was some of it improvised? Like, how much of it was improvised? How much was scripted?
Mostly scripted. I mean, he would throw us in those open mics and things like that. And so, like, in the Montgomery BART station, you know, where it's empty, you know, there's an older guy that looks a little interested. And then there's a young guy, and Don Allen is showing him his record collection.
I love that.
That guy just walked up. Both
no
of those
way.
Guys just walked up.
Oh, I thought for sure he was an actor.
I think not.
There was an actor that
maybe
Vincent.
It was the young guy, but not the older guy.
Yeah, one of those guys was an actor.
Yeah, I think it had to
have been the guy with the records. The young guy.
Yeah, I think he was the one that was scripted. But in other scenes, you kind of go, okay, so that just happened. Like where in the Taste the Biscuit scene at the beginning, where we're sitting there going, waiting for Don. And this cute girl comes up and offers him her sandwich, and he throws it at Tom, throws it at her, and goes, "I'm not homeless." That was one of the crew.
Oh, that was great!
That was totally scripted. Yeah. Totally scripted.
Almost everything.
It was
scripted. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Almost everything.
One take.
I love the blanket.
Oh my God!
If you can't wake up with toasters and moose on top of you, that's the next best thing or something.
Oh my God.
I still have the blanket. I'm looking at it, actually. You want to see it?
Yeah.
I'll be right back.
Yeah.
I have the original coffee mug that we had in the movie.
Oh, okay.
Just both ran away. Sorry about that.
That's okay.
Oh, hell.
Taste the biscuit. Taste the goodness of the biscuit and the honey song. There we go.
I don't know how much of this you can see.
Okay. Oh, that's good. There you are. Is that how she looks? That's photoshopped.
Yeah, it was some kind of, it's woven. It's not like the fleece stuff we have now. It was woven. It is one of a kind, and it was a one of a kind order. So it was woven. And yeah, the photographic image, which it was a photograph we took at the time, you know, during the movie, it's frighteningly accurate.
Well, I was quoting you from the movie.
You're right.
Like, is that how I look?
Have I always looked like that?
Yeah.
And this is the ones we have on the website are black, I think, but this was from the movie.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Great. Yeah. Toasters and
I don't have mine anymore, cracked.
Yeah.
Well, you have to get another one on your website.
And the Jesus pencils are gone.
Oh, yeah. God, the Jesus pencils. That looks like Jesus.
Well, those were actually from one of his very first movies called I Am Jesus Christ. And I think Jesus Christ is auditioning for a musical.
I love Vincent.
Yeah.
God, he's great.
Yeah.
I'd love to talk to him.
I think you would. He's quite
Maybe you could send me his contact info.
Sure. And he has a band now, and I've been in several of the band's music videos. And they're very Vincent. I mean, the song he came out with an album last year called The Natural World, and it's wild and weird, and yet there's some very sweet stuff in it. You know, there's like things about the way we live, which is, you know, not necessarily a good thing. But it's fun too.
Although, he should collaborate with Christopher Guest and Weird Al Yankovic. And they should do something together. It would be like the most. It would win Academy Awards.
That would be beyond amazing.
People have mentioned, you know, him and those guys. Also, believe it or not, John Waters.
You know, oh yeah, for sure.
Yeah, and they go, dude, and I'm like, yeah, this, and I think it's.
The movie is similar to Hairspray. Go ahead, sorry.
No, it's all right.
Yeah.
I mean, that's why I think we always want to mention him and go, you know, we're doing our thing in it for damn sure. And yes, we are putting it in, especially, you know, pretty much daily these days.
Yeah. But
Vincent really is, you know, the creative spirit behind that. And he does so many other things. You know, on top of a full-time job, you know, the whole nine yards.
Yeah, what does he do for a living?
He is now an office manager,
a building manager, like.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it's in Oakland.
Chronicle Books, I think is where.
Yeah. Yeah, he worked for a library when we were doing Chickens in the Shadows. And amazingly, he would save up money from his job Now, he may have used credit cards too, but that's how he paid for the movie. Now I think he has a better job. But God, it's amazing what he can do with Zippo budget.
Were there any scenes? I mean, you can really. I mean, and that was actually, and that was back in 2010 before you could use an iPhone to make a movie.
I mean,
now you can make a movie with your iPhone, does it in 4K, and have all these attachments you can stick on.
Right.
So,
although he's still using cameras, and he uses a camera crew and whatnot, you know.
Yeah.
All nine yards.
Were there any scenes that were cut that you wished were in the film?
Oh, I don't know about that.
I remember there was one. I don't know. I don't think this was in the script. But we stopped at like an outhouse, and I said, "Oh, Vincent, you have to film me when I come out of the outhouse." And he did, and I'm like, "Oh, you have to put that in the film or something." But you know, it wasn't in the script, I don't think, and it obviously didn't make it to the film.
God, I can't think.
I remember being a little disappointed that there wasn't the scene of Moose coming out of the outhouse.
Well, it seems like he was very efficient and planned everything really well, and
oh yeah.
Because you did it in such a short time, and you did a lot with one take, apparently.
Yeah, and he would do. Oh yeah, a lot of things, but he would do. He's very structured, and yet he knows how to roll with it. And
totally.
Yeah, so like he came to my house, and he goes, "I was living in San Jose at the time, South San Jose," and he goes, "This is a pretty groovy place. Would you mind if we shot the beginning scenes here?" And I'm like, "No, that'd be great." So that's at my old house, you know, when Don Allen comes in with the blanket, you know, and we pack up in the morning in the driveway.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Yes. Vincent is very good at like, just like Estelle said, rolling with it. Cause the Britannia Arms, I think it was, we scoped the place out a week before and they had this great room.
Oh yeah.
With a stage off to the side. We're like, "Oh, this is perfect." And then a week later we came in to shoot the scene. And they had walled it off. It was just that drywall behind us. That's why there's drywall behind us, because it was like that room with the stage was completely walled off. So Vincent had to, you know, go, "Well, we're just going to make it work."
Yeah.
Is the Britannia Arms where you had the first song at the beginning?
No, it was later on, and it was where Hunchback, "I'm going to hunt you from."
Oh, okay. With the that's the big drywall behind.
Yeah,
okay.
That's what we did, that round first song, and around.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. As the big, I saw the drywall behind you, which actually made it better because the drywall looked like you were just in some crappy old place.
Yeah.
Added to the feeling.
Yeah. The opening song, "Rock Your Body Home," which is at the end of the movie, that was in Panama Red.
Yeah. At the beginning and the end. Yeah.
Okay. All right. Panama Red.
Concord, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. And actually, the very last little scene. Which looks like something from a grade C La Dolce Vita or something. That was shot in.
You talk about the Easter egg thing?
Yes, the Easter egg.
Yeah.
That was shot in Vincent's apartment at the time in San Francisco.
Oh, okay.
I was I go, "Where are we going to shoot this?" He goes, "My apartment."
Where did he find the young ladies who were also in this scene?
I think he probably put a notice. I don't know where. Craigslist. Or
because they were very convincing.
I don't know. Yeah, but that was pretty
As
good.
As were you.
This was before OnlyFans.
Oh, my God. Let me show you how it's done.
Yeah.
Ow!
I mean, the thing with the dollar bill.
Oh, my God. And the guy, and I never noticed this until more recently, the guy's going,
I didn't have to go watch it again. I'm so glad I kept it going. I mean, I'm sure a lot of people miss that.
They do.
Oh, yeah.
They do. And people started mentioning it because I had forgotten about it too. In fact, I was watching it and I went, "Oh, yeah."
I love how it refers back to a little line you had just before.
Yeah, LA Zoo. Yeah. This little, you know, the title has nothing to do with the movie, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah.
We had a screening last year, like I think it was around this time last year, at a place, I can't remember, the Clarion.
San Francisco.
Yeah, it was in Chinatown. And yeah. we had a screening, and when the credits came on, they turned on all the lights, and the people that had seen the movie before were like, "No, no, no, no."
It's the not over. Yeah, that was great. That was great.
Pretty funny.
Yeah.
We're not really in touch with T.M. Connolly, who was the guy who played Don Allen. I think he got in touch with Vincent when all this kind of went viral and we thought we were going to see him.
Yeah.
He's never shown up. And I thought he was just lovely. And
oh, me too. Yeah.
Same with the little girl. She's now she lives up in Sacramento somewhere. And I she was heard really from good. Her and then.
How weird. You would think they'd want to.
I know.
Have fun. Yeah. And there's little things in the movie too, where like when the waitress like just breaks the fourth wall for some absurd reason.
Oh, at the Malibu Grand Prix.
Yeah. It's like, I don't like people acting that way, but it was nice to, I won't screw it up for people.
Yeah.
I mean, that was hilarious.
Yes. It was
like completely out of the blue. And then I think it was the only time in the movie where that happened.
Mm-hmm.
I think
you're
and,
right.
And it breaks all rules of movie making.
And I bet he did it on purpose.
It was perfect.
Oh, I'm sure. Yeah. I'm sure it was on purpose.
Yeah.
How did you do the video of the one that he sent to America's Got Talent? I guess it just had to do with the way he did the underpants song.
We went to a Star and the Plow or the Plow
and Stars
in Berkeley at night. Okay. And again, another open mic. And he deliberately, you know, did the camera, you know, like that. Okay. And I think he might have recorded on his phone for all I know.
It looks like me.
Yeah, because the quality is sort of, you know.
Bad, which it should be. Yeah.
Yeah. And yet, you know, another friend of an acting friend happened to be in Berkeley. And so there was one friendly face out there.
Oh, okay.
And I had a wig on. And I think maybe you had a cap or something.
Oh, yeah. And you made my.
We darkened your beard or whatever.
It's hard to tell because it's so bad.
And we wore different clothes.
Yeah. Yeah.
So,
go ahead. Sorry.
Oh, I was just going to say, as you know from seeing the film, like a lot of the songs, Moose doesn't actually play because he programs the keyboard.
I know. She says that later. Like, can't you just play so I can?
I learned all the songs well enough where I could, like, fake, like, okay, there's a, you know, but I really probably wouldn't have been able to actually play them at the time. But, you know, now I'm playing them because we're on TikTok. But I was going to say,
right?
I did play when we did Spooky Tune. I did.
Oh, that's right. That was a Casio, huh?
And obviously I played, I think, on the Disconnect song. But I was going to say the Underwear song, for some reason, was like the hardest song for me because Vincent wrote it in a certain way where you're saying, where's my underpants?
Certain number of times.
Like a certain number of times. And then you go, where did my underpants go? And then you sing where's my underpants a bunch more times, but it's a different number than the first time.
Yeah, it's like so 5 times the first time and 7 times the next time.
Oh, it's like Sweeney Todd.
And it, yeah.
Sorry, I was in Sweeney Todd. You have to do like Sweeney.
I hear you. You just kind of go.
But like, Vincent deliberately wrote it a certain way. So like when we started performing it, he's like, no, that's not right. You have to get
Yeah. Yeah. At one point, Tom was, you know, looking out for me, and these songs were difficult to sing. You know, even though I kind of had the range for it, my voice has changed a little and I think is more comfortable with a lot of it. But Tom, you know, said, you know, some of these seem a little low, you know, maybe Estelle could hit them better if and he goes, no, that's the way I want them.
I was exactly.
Well, like, he was right because it was,
inside I'm like,
they were kind of, yeah, they were kind of low
and
for
awkward.
You, which actually is what makes it so what it is.
Yeah. At the time, I thought he hates me.
No, you don't. Like the way he made the movie, you don't want it to be perfectly in your range.
I just want it
because
to be
then decent. It wouldn't have that little edge of pathos or
yeah. I mean, I'm
us
sure
feeling sorry for
him. He goes, I'm sure he went, oh, this is dreadful. Exactly what I wanted.
So So, Ray, do you know that Toasters and Moose performed at South by Southwest this year?
No.
Yes. Yes. Wow. We were invited by Terry Crews. In fact, speak of America's Got Talent, he's the host.
Yeah. He's a huge Toasters and Moose fan.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. And we, Armani White, who's a rapper I'd never heard of, they're very good,
opened
for us. And then we opened for Thundercat. You know who that is?
Yeah.
I've
heard of them. I don't know their music. I've heard of them.
He's great. He's like kind of a cross between hip hop and jazz and Chick Corea and
wow.
Some of his, you know, the old, you know, jazz fusion guys. Because some of his stuff is like, I was like, oh my God.
Yeah. Vincent would occasionally field these requests like, oh, you come play party in Pittsburgh, PA, or, you know, and like none of these things actually materialized. And then Terry contacted us and we're like, let's see what happens. And it actually happened. He hired us to play. He had a faux presidential campaign rally for his character, President Camacho, which is a character he played in this cult film, Idiocracy, which is hilarious.
You know, Idiocracy, Ray?
No, I don't.
I didn't either. But he plays, it's in the set in the future, and he is the president.
What's it called? States.
Idiocracy.
Okay. Idiocracy.
And so and they had Vincent write a campaign song for the party. There was like 600 people there. It was wild.
We did a 30-minute set. We had no idea like how people would respond, and they adored us.
Well, we came out and Armani White was very energetic and got them all, you know, going. And we come out and everybody looks at us. They're all pretty young mostly. And they're like, wow, they're old. They're white. They're cute. What do they do?
They're cute.
Our first song was I'm Not Homeless. And they were singing along.
Oh, yeah. They were singing and dancing with it. That was great.
You know where you guys would be a huge hit? But it might be kind of expensive, but Edinburgh Fringe Festival.
Ooh. Oh, let's go.
Ooh. You would sell out.
I went there in 2003 for some other reason, at some other show, but I'd love to go back to Edinburgh.
I think you'd do very well there.
That reminds me, Ray, you remember a lady, she just recently passed away in the last year or two. Her name was Ruth, I think. And she was like this
Ruth E.
comic, like grandma comic. And she played Edinburgh every year. What is her name?
Is she from around here?
Yeah, she was a Bay Area gal.
Really? Her name is Ruth?
I think her name was Ruth.
I don't know.
That sounds familiar, but I don't know.
I was flashing on her because she would go to that Fringe Festival every year.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The Fringe
she was like
Festival
in her 80s
cool.
and doing stand-up.
Yeah.
I think you guys, I know it's a lot of work to get over there, but I think you'd be a huge hit there.
It would be fun.
Yeah.
You're right. It's a lot to arrange, but.
Yeah, it's a lot. Cool. It's a lot.
Yeah,
we do have some fans across the pond.
Yeah,
yeah,
but you might be able. I think that if you did as well as I think you might be able to pay for it.
That would be nice.
That would be nice
for that. Yeah,
because it's kind of act that people love there.
Yeah, you know? I think so. Yeah. I think they would actually.
Yeah, yeah.
Well, my feeling is like I said, we did a 30-minute set at South by Southwest. I feel like 30 minutes is perfect for Toasters and Moose.
Yeah, well, if you go to the Fringe Festival, at least when I went, that this is, you know, literally 20 years ago, the performance length is an hour max.
Yeah.
Oh, so, maybe work.
I think you could stretch it out to 45 and
get away with it. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, so it's like the
You could do a dance break, Tom.
Well, you could have a director and come up with some dialogue and stuff.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, Vincent created some dialogue for us when we played in Austin for South by Southwest.
Oh, yeah.
So. Yeah.
A few bits. He did an underwear bit. So when we did Where's My Underpants, he had put clean, you know, packages of new underwear underneath these various tables and counters and stuff. And then President Camacho was throwing his T-shirts at the crowd. So they were all like scrambling.
People were throwing the underwear. I mean, it was.
I love it.
Yeah.
God, it's so great. This is what we need these days, you know?
It is.
I think that's the
negative.
If you get a chance to read the Rolling Stone interview, I mean, I thought the guy was going to be real snarky with, and he was very nice, and he really got it. And at the end, he said, you know, this is, I think, you know, I think they, in a sense, he said, you know, they're flawed and earnest and they're fun and it's absurd. And God knows we need something like that right now.
Exactly. That's how I feel.
I think that's why this is like caught on when it did. It's just like the perfect timing.
Yeah.
Yes. Because like usually when you turn on the news or you turn on the TV or you look at YouTube, it's just, you know, Trump this, Biden that, war, and like after just like wears you down, and then all of a sudden there's where's the taste of the biscuit. And like your life is transformed.
It used to be cat videos and now it's taste the biscuit.
Yeah. Well, thanks so much for coming on. I really appreciate it. This is a lot of fun.
Good.
It's a blast. Thank you.
We had a great time, and I'm loving seeing you. We'll have to catch up and see, you know, aside from this, what, you know, you've been up to and I've been up to, but I'm
we should
glad
get together for
Tom.
Coffee or something, the three of us.
Yeah. It'd be fun.
Yeah. All right.